All right, today we will try to work out the problem of the diffusion of a free particle in a fluid in the presence of an external magnetic field. So, this is diffusion. In a magnetic field. We'll assume a field is constant in space and time, and there's a magnetic field B, and we have a particle of charge Q and mass m in moving in this field. As usual, the particle is imagined to be inside a heat bath at some fixed temperature T, and the question is, what does the diffusion look like? What does the diffusion coefficient look like in this case? It's a simple exercise because, as we know, the Lorentz force on the particle due to the magnetic field is linear in the velocity, and as soon as we have a linear problem, the Langevin equation can be solved explicitly. So let's write it out step by step. We look at the velocity distribution as well. So let's start by saying that the particle has a velocity v, and v dot is equal to minus gamma times v. That's the usual friction that we put in, plus Q over m, that's the charge over the mass, times v cross b. Some constant magnetic field b is applied, and then there's the usual noise term, which as usual we'll write as root gamma over m eta of t, and this is Gaussian white noise. So its properties are any component eta j of t has zero value average, and eta j of t eta k of t prime is delta of t minus t prime. So it's the usual Gaussian white noise, and this is the extra term out here. Okay. In component form, we need that, so let's write it out. Vj dot of t equal to minus gamma Vj of t plus q over m. And we need the j component of this cross product, which of course is epsilon j k l v k b l plus square root of gamma over m eta j of t. For each Cartesian component, we have this, and the components are mixed up with each other because of the magnetic field. Okay. Now, as always, we are going to say gamma is 2 m gamma k Boltzmann t, that's the fluctuation dissipation relation, that doesn't change. And the first thing we got to ask is, what do we expect? We expect that when you have this magnetic field on, the Maxwellian distribution of velocities of the particle in thermal equilibrium is not disturbed, because the magnetic field doesn't do any work on these particles, it doesn't accelerate them so as to change the kinetic energy, it merely changes the direction of the velocity for every particle. But it doesn't do anything else. So physically, I expect that the equilibrium distribution will be Maxwellian, will continue to remain Maxwellian. However, the Fokker-Planck equation, which is the conditional equation satisfied by the conditional probability density of the velocity, will of course show you show a presence of this field. It will certainly have an effect there. But asymptotically, as t tends to infinity, I expect it will tend again to the Maxwellian distribution, right? Okay. So we will look at the velocity Fokker-Planck equation. We could also look at the phase space Fokker-Planck equation, the full one in R and V, because we know how to do that. We know how to write down the Fokker-Planck equation for the phase space density rho as a function of R, V and T in the presence of a linear force of this kind. So we will do that as well. And then we try to compute what's the distribution, etc. So corresponding to this, we can write down the Fokker-Planck equation immediately at once. So if you write it in this language, for example, this will imply the Fokker-Planck equation for P of VT given some V naught. So, given some initial velocity V naught, we can write down what the Fokker-Planck equation for this is, and that is going to read delta P over delta T equal to, you have a minus sign there, so it is gamma times delta over delta Vj, Vjp, that is this part is taken care of, plus you can write it in a number of ways, but here is the most convenient way of writing this, plus Q over m epsilon jkl bl, that is a constant, so that comes out, and then delta over delta Vj of Vkp in that fashion, plus half this guy. So, the square of it divided by 2 in the square, this factor will go away, and then this gets squared, so it is gamma kt over m, k Boltzmann t over m. Delta jk d2p over delta vj delta vk. This is essentially the del squared operator, as you can see, in velocity space. So, that is the Fokker-Planck equation satisfied by the conditional density here for a given velocity. So, the initial condition on this is just a delta function, 3-dimensional delta function at v equal to v naught. Now, we can write this in vector form as well. So, let us do that. Let us put del V equal to gradient operator with respect to velocity components. So, just for notation, let us call that del V, otherwise I write del, it is could be with respect to position as well. So, let us just call it del sub v, and then what does this say? It says delta p over delta t equal to gamma times del v dot vp. It is just the divergence here, as you can see, because it is the same j, and then this guy here gives you minus, oh sorry, I got to be careful with the signs. This was a plus here, so this equation has a minus. The drift comes with a minus f of x, as if you remember. So, minus q over m, we could write this down directly as it is. So, it is del v dot v cross b times p. So, it is the divergence of that, that is the drift part of it, plus gamma k Boltzmann t over m del v squared on p. So, that is the equation satisfied by, that is the Fokker-Planck equation. Okay. The task is to solve this equation subject to this initial condition. Okay. By the way, a little bit of simplification, it is convenient. As you can see, I have taken the magnetic field to be in some arbitrary direction. It is convenient to do that rather than specialize to the z direction or anything like that, but you can see the structure of this whole thing coming out more interestingly if you keep a general direction. So, let us say that the magnetic field B equal to B times some unit vector n in some arbitrary direction, right. Then what you have here is QB over m. So, let us simplify this equation a little bit. In fact, let us simplify this equation a little bit. So, for BL, I am going to write B times n sub L, and then I put a B here. N sub L Vk, and let us define a matrix M. So, let us define a matrix M Jk to be equal to epsilon Jkl NL. Okay. A matrix whose elements Jk are given by epsilon jkl NL. It's clear that this is an antisymmetric matrix because the epsilon symbol is totally antisymmetric in any two indices. So that's one fact we need to know right away, that MJK equal to minus MKJ. It's antisymmetric, this guy. Okay. Then if you look at this, for instance, or in that language, it doesn't matter which way you look at it. This is going to have two derivatives, one of which is going to be delta Vk over delta Vj, that's delta Jk times P, but delta Jk with epsilon Jk contracted will give you 0, because this is symmetric and that's antisymmetric. And the other term is Vk times delta P over delta Vj, and that of course survives, right. So this means that you can simplify this a little bit and write this as del V on P dotted with V cross B, because the del V dot V cross B is 0 identically, right. So divergence of a vector times a scalar is a scalar times the divergence of the vector plus the vector dotted with the gradient of the scalar, and the first term vanishes in this case. So we could also write this as V cross B dotted with del V. So a little simplification. Now what does this do? This thing is what we called MJK, so let us call this MJK. And QB over M is a direct physical significance. It is the cyclotron frequency for a charge particle of charge Q and mass M in a field of magnitude B. So let us call this omega cyclotron. So out there we have omega C okay. Now we could either try to solve this equation directly, or we write this Fokker-Planck equation down and try to solve this, doesn't matter either way. We would like to get at the velocity correlation function, and after that we would try to use the Kubo formula to find the diffusion constant. We will also find the diffusion constant by another method, going to the high friction limit and seeing whether we get the same answer or not. This is what we want to check out. First, before anything else, this thing here, what does it do? Once you have a magnetic field applied in some constant direction and you have some velocity to start with V naught, and I apply this field, what happens to this V naught is that it starts precessing around the direction of n, the unit vector n, right. So this is all that happens. I mean, if you look at, without any noise, without a damping, without an external, without anything except the external field, just a free particle, and it satisfies an equation of this kind, V dot equal to omega C M, this is a matrix times V, that is what this equation is. This is equal to that. All I have written is V dot is Q over M V cross B in this language, okay. Now what is the solution to this equation? For a given initial condition, so the initial condition is V naught. So what happens is that if you have this as the unit vector n and you have a velocity V naught here, you know that as time progresses, this V naught precesses in a cone around this direction of n. Okay. This means that the component of V along the field doesn't change. Whereas the components, the perpendicular components, the transverse components, they perform circular motion with a phase difference of pi over 2, right. So Vx and Vy exchange roles, they move in a circle, and you have this precessional motion. So what is the solution to this guy here, the formal solution to this? This thing will imply that V of t equal to e to the m omega c t acting on V naught. That is the formal solution to this guy, right. And what we have, M is a rotation matrix, as we will see in a minute, and we want to exponentiate it, right? And the angle changes at a constant rate, omega c. So what we need is a finite rotation formula in this case. Many ways of writing this down. I'm sure you're familiar with this from what happens if you have a given vector r and then you have some direction, unit direction n, and you make a rotation about this direction, rotate the coordinate system about this point through an angle psi. You get a finite rotation formula. Yeah.
Is m the rotation matrix or is it's just a generator of the rotation?
It's actually the generator. This guy is like a rotation matrix through an angle omega c t, as you can see, right? Now, of course, you need to do this, you need to compute this quantity, but that's not very hard to do. Computing this quantity is not hard to do, because let's do that as a side exercise. So e to the m omega c t equal to I plus m omega c t plus m squared over 2 factorial omega c t whole squared dot 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 etc. Right. Now, what is it about m that strikes you immediately? Because m squared is going to be interesting. M has elements jk equal to epsilon jkl nl, where this is a component of a unit vector. And what's m squared jk equal to? Well, you got to put two of these epsilons and then use the fact that this is a unit vector, etc., and simplify it using this formula for what happens when you take two epsilons and contract one index. You get a product of delta functions, etc., Kronecker deltas, right? So in this case, this turns out to be equal to nj nk minus delta ij. And what does m cube become? Well, you put another n here, you put another m here and use this fact here, and sorry, not ij, jk. M cube becomes equal to minus m itself. Okay. Check this out. So m4 is minus m squared, and so on. So therefore, the exponential collapses completely, and you can write down a formula for this guy. So this thing here is equal to, if I exponentiate it fully, it's I plus m sine omega c t plus m squared 1 minus cosine omega c t. Because you see, the m squared guy starts with omega t squared over 2 factorial, so it's you've got to put that one in separately. And it's of course cosine has minus t squared, this got a plus here, so it's 1 minus cos omega t. And therefore, you can write this down explicitly, and I write down fully what this thing is. So it says this guy, by the way, if I change this plus or minus, all that happens is t goes to minus t, so this becomes plus or minus. Well, that's an interesting little exercise to play with this, and it will reproduce for you the finite rotation formula. So let's write that down and see what happens. The formula in fact is that if you have a unit vector n and I take a certain vector a and rotate it about this direction n, rotate the coordinate system through an angle psi, then a goes to a prime. Which is precisely e to the m psi acting on this original vector a. So it's going to be equal to a cos psi plus 1 minus cos psi times n dot a unit vector in the direction n. So if I rotate this, there are only three possibilities. One of them is it is along the original vector a, the new vector has a component along a, it has a component along n and a component perpendicular to these two guys, right. So this plus sin psi times a cross n. This is called the finite rotation formula. Can establish this for the coordinates, and after that of course a vector is a quantity which transforms exactly like the coordinates, and therefore any vector would transform in this fashion. So in fact we can write down the answer now to what the solution to the Fokker-Planck equation is explicitly, okay. Because I have already said we have given physical argument to show that the energy does not change at all. All that happens is that the velocity starts precessing. Every velocity processes, yeah. Pardon me. Ah, good question. So I'm rotating the coordinate system about this point, about the direction of the unit vector n. So if the original coordinate system had an x-axis like that, it now has a thing like this, and the amount of rotation in that plane is psi. The amount, the angle through which you have rotated to go to another point on the tip of this cone. Okay. In our problem, this rotation is happening all the time, the precession. So psi is replaced by omega ct. So what it is saying is that if you just had a magnetic field and you looked at just that original equation, so the equation is V dot equal to omega c m acting on V. This will imply that V at any time t, would be equal to e to the m omega c t acting on V naught, and that can be written down. This is equal to cos omega c t times V naught plus 1 minus cos omega c t times V naught dot n times n plus sin omega c t times V naught cross n. So that is the explicit solution in general to what happens to any initial velocity V naught. At time t, this is what it does, okay. Let us give this a name. Let us call this u as a function of time and of course the initial velocity V naught. So let us define u to be this, okay. The magnitude of u is the same as the magnitude of V naught. Nothing happens, it just precesses, you know. Now what do you think will be the solution to this guy? We can do this painfully, but we can write this down on physical grounds, Vt, V naught. What do you think this will be? In the absence of the magnetic field, this is the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck distribution, okay. And the Ornstein-Uhlenbeck distribution has the variance goes like 1 minus e to the minus 2 gamma t. And the mean value decays to 0 like e to the minus gamma t, right. So the original thing distribution was e to the minus v naught e to the minus gamma t whole squared. Now instead of v naught, you are going to have u of t comma v naught. That is all that will happen. So we can write this solution down. It is going to be equal to m over 2 pi k Boltzmann t. 1 minus e to the minus 2 gamma t, the whole thing to the power 3 halves because you got 3 components, and then this 3 dimensional Gaussian e to the exponential of minus v minus u of t comma v naught that's a vector, e to the minus gamma t whole squared divided by, of course, there's a minus m over 2 k Boltzmann t 1 minus e to the minus 2 gamma t. So that's the solution to the Fokker-Planck equation. Okay. All that happens in the magnetic field is that this V naught gets rotated, keeps rotating, and the damping is exactly as before. That happens because the Langevin equation has a minus gamma V on the right hand side, it damps it out, and the portion V cross B, this portion is a linear drift, but it's a reversible part. This is the reversible drift, this is irreversible, it's due to dissipation. And of course that also represents the effect of dissipation. So you can see from this, you can check backwards that it satisfies the Fokker-Planck equation, but you can see from this that as t tends to infinity, this goes to the Maxwellian. This part goes away, it's m over 2 pi kt to the 3 halves e to the minus mv squared over 2 kt. So it certainly goes to the Maxwellian distribution as t tends to infinity. That's the equilibrium distribution, the Maxwellian, three-dimensional Maxwellian distribution. Our task is slightly different. We want to actually find out what happens to the diffusion. How does it diffuse, right? For that, we already have a formula. We have a formula which says that the integral of the velocity correlation from 0 to infinity is in fact the diffusion coefficient. We explicitly showed that by looking at the long time behavior of the mean square displacement. Now we have indices to worry about, so we got to be a little more cautious. So let's see if we can do that. And we don't have a diffusion coefficient, we have a diffusion tensor now, because the coefficient here, when you write the diffusion equation down, since we have three components, we're going to have a diffusion tensor in this business. So let's see what this is done. Let's first find what the correlation, velocity correlation is. So we'll go back and use the fact that we know the velocity is a stationary random process here. So since we know that, we can do this a little heuristically. Let's write Vj dot of t equal to minus gamma Vj of t plus, and then there was an omega c m, and if I recall right, it was mjk vk of t, and then there was a portion which was plus square root of gamma over m eta j of t. That was the Langevin equation, right? We'd like to find out what this quantity is. We are seeking Cij of t, let's define this to be equal to Vi of 0 Vj of t. This is the quantity we want. This angular average is the full average in equilibrium. Now what's this quantity equal to? What's Cij of 0 equal to? What is this guy equal to? So it's the correlation between the Cartesian component, ith component at a given time 0, with the jth component at the same time. Now independent, different Cartesian components are independent of each other, this correlation is 0 in equilibrium. But when the two are equal, it is equal to kT over m, right? So we know that this guy equal to kBT over m delta ij. For each component, it is kT over m. For each I equal to j, it's equal to kT over m. Just the mean square velocity, any given component. Okay. So let's try to compute that. What we need to do is to multiply this on the left by Vi of 0 and then take averages. Okay. times this whole thing. And then take averages. So the left hand side says d over dt of Cij of t equal to minus gamma Cij of t this side, plus omega C mjk Cik of t. This is a constant matrix, and then Vi of 0, Vk of t is Cik at time t, plus the average value plus square root of gamma over m, the average value of Vi of 0 with eta j of t. What's this equal to? That's 0 because of causality. It says the force for any t greater than 0 can't dictate what the velocity was. Is the velocity at an earlier time is not dependent on the force at a later time. Even at equal times, this correlation is 0. It's the acceleration that's correlated to the force, right? So this vanishes. We are now computing this for t greater than 0, because that's really what we need for the diffusion coefficient. When you do it for t less than 0, we can compute it, you got to be a little careful. You got to be a little careful because remember that without this magnetic field, the formula you got for the velocity correlation was e to the minus gamma modulus t. And now there are going to be terms depending on the magnetic field. So when you take t to minus t, you have to be a little cautious. Because although this dissipation term will be e to the minus gamma modulus t, the fact is that as t goes to minus t, you should also be careful to reverse the sign of the magnetic field. Okay? So for time reversal operation, when you have an external magnetic field, time reversal is taking t to minus t and the applied field b to minus b. And the physical reason for that, of course, is that if this field is imagined to be from due to some electromagnet, some electric charge is moving, if you reverse time, the current flows in the opposite direction, the field changes sign. Okay? So the time reversal property of B is actually B goes to minus B, unlike E. Okay. Okay. So this term is 0. Now this looks almost like a matrix multiplication, except that you have a little problem. There's a jk and an ik, but of course we know that mjk is minus mkj. So we can write this as equal to minus gamma cij of t plus omega c cik. We put a minus sign. Let's write this properly. Mkj. Okay. So if I call C the matrix, I have d over dt C, d over dt of the matrix C of t, this is a matrix now, equal to minus C of t times gamma I plus omega C m on the right hand side, because it's Cik mkj. Okay. And what's the solution to this guy? This implies that C of t equal to e to the power minus, the other way, C of 0 with e to the minus gamma I plus omega C m on t. It's on acting on the right, so I better be careful, keep it there. Okay. Of course, this is also equal to e to the minus unit matrix commutes with everything, so I can just bring it out. So it's equal to e to the minus gamma t C of 0 e to the minus omega C m, minus m omega C t. Okay. And that's it. But what C of 0? Yeah, so this will of course imply that C of 0 equal to K Boltzmann T over M times the identity matrix. Delta ij is just the component of the identity matrix. So this becomes equal to K Boltzmann T over M e to the minus gamma T, and all we got to do now is find e to the minus M omega C. But we did that already. We have already done it. It is sitting here. Sitting at that point. Right? So we are in good shape. We actually have an expression for the correlation. So this says that C of t is equal to e to the minus gamma kt over m e to the minus gamma t times I plus m squared 1 minus cos omega c t minus, because we got a minus m c t, m sine omega c t. So we have the matrix explicitly, the correlation matrix. And what we need is the ijth component of it. So it says Cij of t equal to K Boltzmann t over m e to the minus gamma t. What is the ijth component of I? The Kronecker delta, of course. Kronecker delta, delta ij plus m squared, remember, was nij minus delta ij. 1 minus cos omega c t, that is this guy here, minus, and recall this fellow was epsilon, we want the ijth component, so it is ijk nk sin omega c t. So we have an explicit formula for the velocity correlation. Right? Remember that if you had a free particle in the absence of the magnetic field, then the different Cartesian components didn't get mixed up as a function of time, and they were uncorrelated. They started uncorrelated, they remained uncorrelated. Now because of the magnetic field, it's scrambling things up. So you've got all kinds of mixtures out here. What we need to compute is the integral of this quantity over t from 0 to infinity. But there is a little change in the formula here, got to be a little cautious here. The Kubo formula for the diffusion constant is now a formula for the diffusion tensor, and it turns out that d, which was equal to integral 0 to infinity dt v of 0 v of t originally. Now the correct formula is dij, the coefficient, because it is a tensor now, diffusion tensor. This is equal to dt cij of t plus cji of t with a half. It is the symmetric part of this coefficient, of this tensor, which turns out to be the diffusion coefficient. We can prove this without much difficulty. I have not done linear response theory explicitly. We have not talked about the Kubo formula and how to derive it for the multi-component case. But in a couple of minutes, we will try to corroborate that this is indeed true. So I will write down the diffusion constant directly by looking at the high friction limit. Okay. So what we need actually is not the integral of this, but the integral of the symmetric part of it. Right? So this says dij equal to the symmetric part, this part is symmetric, this part is symmetric, this part is anti-symmetric in I and J, and so when I take the symmetric part, it vanishes, doesn't contribute. And there's a factor half, I can get rid of that half by adding this twice, dividing by 2. So this immediately becomes K Boltzmann T over M. By the way, a little bit of simplification here itself. Let's write this whole thing as equal to K Boltzmann T over M e to the minus gamma t, and then there's an ni nj let's write it like this. This thing here is ni nj 1 minus cos omega c t plus delta ij cos omega c t, because delta ij times 1 and this cancels out here. So we have a small simplification here in this fashion. So let's write this cij of t equal to K Boltzmann T over M e to the minus gamma T times, we rearrange terms a little bit, ni nj plus delta ij minus ni nj cos omega c t minus this other guy epsilon ij k n k sine. Let's check if that's correct. That's correct. That's right. Yeah. Now you'll recognize that this is the longitudinal part and that's the transverse part of this tensor. And that's the antisymmetric part, the last term. Okay. So if I compute now the diffusion coefficient, this guy here is equal to K Boltzmann T over M e to the minus, oh sorry, got to integrate over that, times I have an ni nj and I integrate e to the minus gamma t. That's just a 1 over gamma, right? So it's ni nj over gamma plus, then there's a delta ij minus ni nj times the integral of e to the minus gamma t cos omega c t, and that's of course gamma divided by gamma squared plus omega c squared, right? That's it. And the other part, last part, vanishes because it's antisymmetric. This is of course the longitudinal part and that's the transverse part. And you can see the two are slightly different, because let's pull out a kt over m gamma and then it's this plus that in this fashion. Okay. So you see at once that in the transverse direction, this, remember that in the original problem, d was equal to kt over m gamma. This followed by consistency in the diffusion limit. We already saw this. This is the Einstein-Sutherland formula. And that's sure there in the longitudinal direction. But in the transverse direction, it's modulated by this factor, which is less than 1. So this shows exactly how the fact that you have the cyclotron precession is inhibiting the diffusion constant. It's still diffusive even in the transverse directions, but it's a smaller diffusion constant. Instead of being a constant, it's dropping off as a function of omega c. When omega c becomes very large, it will of course go to 0 in this direction. Okay. So you can easily see, if you took a special case, if you took n to be equal to 0, 0, 1, say. So you have a field in the z direction, okay. Then it's immediately clear that d becomes diagonal, and you have d11 equal to d22. So you put n1 equal to n2 equal to 0, and then only this term contributes. So you have kbt m gamma times gamma squared over, whereas d33 then you get the 1 cancels out here and you get just this portion, which is kbt gamma. Okay, so this is equal to d transverse equal to, this is equal to the longitude. Okay. So it shows this very simple problem exactly how the diffusion is inhibited. It is still diffusive, its mean square displacement still diverges, but the fact that this particle is constantly pulled back into a circle in the transverse direction lowers your effective diffusion constant by this amount. Okay. This is the simplest model. Now of course you have a lot of other complications in a real plasma, you have many more complexities, but this tells you already how this thing happens, the simplest instance. Okay. Can we see this directly from the Langevin equation? Yes, because what you need to do is this, and I am going to leave the details as an exercise. What you need to do is the following. Let us go back to the original equation, the Langevin equation itself, and write it in the following way. We have V dot equal to minus gamma V plus Q over M V cross P plus root gamma over m eta of t in this fashion, right. And we wrote this in a somewhat simpler form, right. We wrote this as equal to minus gamma times the unit matrix plus plus the matrix omega c m acting on V. We wrote it in this form, right. Now in the high friction limit, the inertia term is negligible, so you can throw that out. And then you have a thing which says gamma I minus omega C m acting on V, which is R dot here, is equal to square root of gamma over m eta of t, where this is Gaussian white noise. So this is the high friction limit or diffusion limit, if you like. But you can rewrite this. This implies that R dot equal to gamma I minus omega C m inverse acting on times square root of gamma over m acting on eta of t. Does this inverse exist? Got to be a little careful here to see if this thing exists. What are the eigenvalues of m itself? Because we know what m is, the mij is epsilon ijk nk, where nk is the component of a unit vector, right. So we can find the eigenvalues of this m very easily. What do you think are the eigenvalues of m? It's we had a property for m, remember that, remember that m cube plus m was equal to 0. right? That's the characteristic polynomial of M. So lambda cube plus lambda is 0, right? What are the eigenvalues of M? 0 and then plus or minus I. So 0 is certainly an eigenvalue of M, and therefore the inverse of M doesn't exist. We don't care. We want the inverse of gamma I minus some number times M. So you can stay away from the eigenvalues depending on what this gamma is. In fact, it's easy to see that this inverse exists. We'll find it explicitly, okay? So there's no problem with that existing at all. But we got an equation which looks like x dot equal to something or the other, some constant, whatever matrix this is, acting on white noise. So remember our original equation, we got x dot equal to square root of 2d times eta, and we at once said, this immediately implies that the probability density of this x satisfies d d2p over dx2. That was my identification of the diffusion constant. All we needed was white noise, and the integral of white noise is diffusion, of course. Stationary white noise. This guy is stationary, this is a constant independent of t, so this whole noise is still a stationary noise. It is still delta correlated. It's still delta correlated because you can see what this noise is like. So let's call h of t equal to, let's define this to be equal to all this garbage, square root of gamma over m gamma I plus minus omega c m inverse, this whole thing acting on this eta of t. Now what is h I of t equal to? It's equal to gamma over m gamma I minus omega c m inverse I k eta k. Agree? And what is h j of t prime? This is equal to square root of gamma over m gamma I minus omega c m inverse j l acting on eta l of t prime. So we can now find out what's hi of t, hj of t prime, and take the average. That's the noise correlation, right? That's equal to gamma over m squared, gamma I minus omega c m inverse ik, gamma I minus omega c m inverse j l, the correlation of eta k with eta l, eta k of t with eta l of t prime. What's that equal to? That's a Kronecker delta, delta k l times a delta function delta of t minus t prime. So this guy is going to have a Kronecker delta k l delta of t minus t prime. And of course you can finish off this immediately because this JLKL, you can get rid of this and make this a JK. So it is still delta correlated. This is still a noise. Exactly. Right? And it's going to be square root of 2 DIJ times a delta function. Side. When I do this for r dot, I am going to get a square root of 2ij, whatever it is. So this is what we need, since we have proved that r dot equal to h of t component by component, right? This will tell you immediately that this noise is like square root of 2 dij for each component acting on the appropriate component of H on that side, on the right hand side. So this will immediately imply dp over dt equal to dij . So you can identify what this dij is from this guy here. Okay. So this is what I'd like you to do. This is 2 dij. Remember, k is cancelled out. So this whole thing . So you can identify what all you have to do is to find this inverse and that inverse. Okay. How are you going to do that? How are you going to find these inverses? Well, once again, we know that if gamma is sufficiently large, which is what you have to do, it is a high friction limit, then of course you can do a binomial expansion of this in powers of m and use the fact again that m cubed is m minus m. So it will again terminate. Once again, okay. If you don't like that, find the Laplace transform, because if you find the Laplace transform of e to the power m omega c t, and you find its Laplace transform, it's e to the minus s t times this guy. Find the Laplace transform of m omega c t, 0 to infinity dt. This is equal to Si minus m omega c inverse. Formally this is true. We already have a formula for this guy in terms of sines, cosines and so on. So put that in and do those simple integrals and you are going to get something which depends on m, something which depends on m squared. That is equal to this guy, and now set s equal to gamma. And you have this inverse. Okay. So there are many tricks for finding out the inverse. You don't have to work extra to do the inverse. It's already there. It's already there explicitly. Okay. Then put that here, whatever expressions you get, and that will and identify that with 2 dij, read off dij. It corroborates the fact that in the diffusion limit, you can directly from the fact that the position, that the velocity is delta correlated, you can actually find out with some coefficient. The coefficient is essentially the diffusion coefficient. We can compute what the D tensor is in this case. Okay. But we can do this in several ways. We also have, you can also compute now the phase space density completely. So you can find out, while we found out P of V comma T for a given V naught, you can also find out what rho of R, V and T given R naught and V naught is explicitly. And that is not very hard to do either, because once you have this expression for the exponential of this M matrix directly, then everything follows automatically. Okay. So in a sense, this completes what happens in the simplest instance of a particle moving in a magnetic field. Okay. It does exactly what we expected on physical grounds. Okay. So let me stop here today and we will come back to noise next time.